Hi everybody, and welcome to the Ambassador of Southern Rock channel. I'm your host, Michael Buffalo Smith. Now if you like the videos that you see on this channel, please subscribe to our channel. Today, I'm happy to welcome my friend, Marshall Chapman, a great singer-songwriter, very prolific songwriter and recording artist, as well as an author and actress. She's done it all. Marshall Chapman, she is great. I hope you guys enjoy the interview. I want to thank Marshall for doing it. So without further ado, we present Marshall Chapman. Okay, we welcome Marshall Chapman to the program. Good Buffalo. Morning. Good morning, Marshall. How are you?
I'm good, Buffalo. How are you?
I'm doing fine. I can't say your name without saying Marshall.
That's how they say it in South Carolina. Don't pronounce those R's.
Yeah, there's no R's at all. No R's.
It's like Sumter, South Carolina. They always say Sumter.
Sumter. That's true. Sumter. And, the more affluent parts of...
Spartanburg.
Most more affluent people in Greenville and Spartanburg, the more affluent they are, the more they do have that accent. Like the
and the more they add syllables, you know, like the name George, that's one syllable. I have a friend in South Carolina who's one of those ladies that I was raised to be, and here's how she says George. You ready?
Oh yeah.
Georgia, four syllables. Georgia.
That reminds me of the preachers that you hear on the radio out of the South that say God, and they say Gawada.
Yeah, God.
Gawada. It's like so. Anyway,
that God though is like an exclamation point.
Yeah, it is. All right. Well, tell me a little bit, if you would, for our viewers about your life growing up here in the beginning, back in the day back in Spartanburg, South Carolina, a little bit about that, how you grew up.
Well, you know, I was born into privilege, which is probably the worst background you could have to end up doing what I did. But in Spartanburg, you know, I grew up in Converse Heights. In Spartanburg, there wasn't really much of a middle class back then. I grew up in the Jim Crow South, you know, segregation. And, you know, if you were black, you were usually working in somebody's house or in their yard that was white. That was just the way it was. And so I tell everybody, I thought I was, there were so many black people in our house, I thought I was black till I was about old enough to look in the mirror. And when I realized I was white, I thought I was sick. Yeah. I thought I needed to go to the doctor. It's like, what's wrong with me? It's kind of like that Twilight Zone episode. But, you know, but that had a big influence on my music because I spent back then, you know, we were in a two-story house in Converse Heights, but we had a basement, and that's where the washing machine and the dryer was in the damn basement. You know, now we have to wash our own clothes and cook our own food, so everything's kind of on the same floor. But back then, we had a black maid down in the basement ironing our damn clothes, and she had a little radio there, and it was tuned to this black station in Spartanburg, you know, and I spent all my time down there with her listening to that little radio, and I'd be hearing, you know, Jackie Wilson and Big Joe Turner and all that stuff, and I would also slick my hair and get my pompadour going and go down there and do my best Elvis for her. She was thrilled when I'd do that. She'd go, "Ooh, child, yeah, you are something else." Now, I knew where my audience was. It was in the basement. But, you know, I grew up, I went to Pine Street Elementary School, and they started the Spartanburg Day School. Back then, those private schools were started so white children wouldn't have to go to school with black children because they thought somehow they were going to dilute our intelligence. Wrong. So, I know it was crazy. I can't believe I'm talking to you like this and that this was something that happened in my lifetime, in our lifetime.
That's amazing.
And then I got sent off to this prep school in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Then it came time for college. And by then I had met a guy who was from the same background as me, Buffalo. His name was Walter Forbes. He just recently passed this year. I met him at a textile convention. I went with my father because my mother was having kind of a nervous breakdown. So I was elected to go with my father to Hollywood Beach, Florida, to an ATMI convention, American Textile Manufacturers Institute. And so we were down there, and there was, the men had on white dinner jackets. He said, we're going to go up to this guy's suite, Mr. Walter Forbes Sr. His son plays guitar, and Dad knew I loved guitar. So we went in there, and here was this guy in a white dinner jacket with big white teeth playing the guitar, and he'd played on the Grand Ole Opry. He also had recorded two albums for RCA that are kind of folk, bluegrass kind of classic albums. And I knew every word to the songs. I learned every song on those albums because Mr. Forbes Sr. sent them to my father when Walter, because he was proud of his son. So I met Forbes that night. I was 16. And then later that summer, Dad sent me to Chattanooga to stay with their family because I wanted to learn more about the guitar. And Walter said, I said, I want you to teach me to play guitar. He said, no, there's somebody in town that's much better than I am. His name's Norman Blake. And Norman had a little office in downtown Chattanooga. This was in the middle of the summer. The office had a little fan in the window going back and forth and long steps you had to climb up. It was hot as hell in there. And I went in there and took about three lessons while I was in Chattanooga. And those are the only guitar lessons I ever had. But he taught me how to Travis pick, do that separation with your thumb and fingers, do the beat with your thumb and the melody with your fingers and all that. And I learned to play Freight Train and all that stuff. But, I just had a different kind of upbringing than most people. But while I was at Forbes's house, he was cleaning, he was filling his own shotgun shells with this little machine he had down in his basement, had music going. And he said, he started talking about college. And I told him I didn't want to go to college. I wanted to do music. He said, well, your family's going to want you to go to college, so you ought to go to Vanderbilt. I said, what's Vanderbilt? I'd never heard of Vanderbilt. He said, well, it's a good school, and your parents will like that. But more importantly, it's in Nashville, and that's where you should be. And I was 16, and, man, that just sunk into me. And I went back to Spartanburg, told everybody I was going to Vanderbilt. Nobody knew what Vanderbilt was. They thought it was some Yankee school up in Pennsylvania or something. Nobody in South Carolina went to Vanderbilt back then. And so I'm going to do a time. I'm going to go get a thing of water that I had for me in the kitchen. I'll be right back, okay?
All right.
Let me go get my water.
Well.
Yeah.
Oh, Marshall's, yeah. Marshall's going to get her water now, so.
Well, I hid it for myself.
You'll notice the wonderful chair that Marshall's sitting in with the stripes. It's very cool. You can probably find one of those in your local furniture store.
Hello.
I was killing time. Hey, there you Cheers. Go. Let's all take a drink. I tell you what, I'm doing coffee right now. My how things have changed.
Anyway, so that, you look back on your life and sometimes there's one or two decisions that you made that forever changed the course of your life. And that was one for me because I was going to Vanderbilt. My parents wanted me to go to Converse or Agnes Scott in Atlanta. I call them lady factories. they keep that thing going. Georgia.
Yeah.
So good to see you. So
yeah.
They keep all that going. Or Agnes Scott or a couple of them in Virginia. Hollins, they went with me. Hell, Daddy didn't even come out to Nashville with us to look at Vanderbilt. My mother brought me out here and to look at Vanderbilt in January 1967, my senior year in high school. And I applied to Vanderbilt. Let's see. I applied to Emory in Atlanta. I applied to Hollins and Converse, because of my family. And I got accepted in all three. Academics was never a problem for me, so I went to Vanderbilt, and I met Cowboy Jack Clement my freshman year because Walter Forbes would drive up from Chattanooga, and he'd take me out, took me to a recording studio. I'm like, Gidget goes to Nashville, and it's like, oh, my God, this is how they make records. And he took me to a studio first, and Bobby Bear was recording. He only did a couple albums for Mercury, and it was one of those sessions. Bear has since become a real good friend. But I love Nashville's great, It's weird right now with coronavirus, Buffalo.
Everything is.
Everything's weird. I'm starting to, you know, I've been to Pawleys Island 5 times since February. I just get in the car and drive. It's 1,200 miles round trip, and I don't think anything. Chris and I will just jump in the car when I start getting squirrely about just being in this place and feeling, you know, I can't get out and play music and see people. The ocean kind of gives me the same thing as a big crowd of people listening to your music, you know?
I sure do.
That ocean will fill you up.
It will. I feel the same way. I really need to get down to one of the beaches too. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you're so lucky to be so close, but I keep having these fantasies of just up and moving down there. They said, why don't you, you know, there's no way I'd want to own 2 homes because I don't even want the one I've got, you know. I wish I lived in something with wheels on it, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Back when I lived in my car, people would tease me, you know. And I'd say, well, you know, you can always live in your car if you need to, but you can't drive your house, you know?
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You know, you've
trying to make you laugh.
Well, that's pretty easy to do. Yeah. For you anyway. I was thinking about when you did your first album, I never will forget the day I went to the record store, to Mercury Music, and bought the Me, I'm Feeling Free album.
Wow.
Yeah, man.
Was that in Spartanburg?
Mercury Music was right over near Spartan Mill. Beside it was Mercury News. So you could get
newspapers.
Books, man. Of course, and then they had the adult section in the back that we weren't allowed to go in. I bought several of my favorite albums there. That was before Westgate Mall took off, you know.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But the
1977.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I remember WRD got a hold of your record, and Billy Mack and all those guys, and they were playing it a lot. And Somewhere South of Macon got to be still one of my favorite songs. I love it. And just Thank wondered you. What your maybe briefly what some of your memories were of as far as doing that first album, how that came to be.
Oh, that first album. Well, you know, I went to Vanderbilt. My parents came out with a U-Haul to take me back to Spartanburg, and I had to tell them I wasn't going back because I had a job slinging beer at a place called the Red Dog Saloon. And it was one of Nashville. It was like pre-Exit Inn underground music club near the Vanderbilt campus that this guy from Mississippi named Red Dog. I remember my grandmother was there that I was named for, you know. Red Dog took us, I took my parents down to the Red Dog Saloon when they came out for my graduation from Vanderbilt. I took them to the Red Dog Saloon, and Red Dog took my parents and Nanny into his office, and he had a bottle of Glenlivet Scotch. My daddy was a Scotch drinker, and they started drinking. And Nanny went, and Red Dog talked like this. He talked like this. Hey, and you know, Nanny kind of swooned and had to go sit in the car. And I said, Mama, what's wrong with Nanny? Does she not feel good? And Mama said, I think Red Dog scared Nanny. So that was my first employer, Red Dog. That's what I did with my, and I started, I was the only waitress. See, I can palm a basketball. Yeah. I was the only waitress who could hold, I don't know, 5 or 6 beer mugs in one hand. That was my claim to fame with my big, fine Vanderbilt degree. And I started, you know, David Allen Coe, Linda Hargrove, Chris Gantry, all those guys. This was before Guy and Rodney even got to town. But eventually I got an apartment for $50 a month, not far from where I live now. I mean, unbelievable. It's like 3 blocks away. I laugh and tell everybody, you know, 50 something years and I've only made it 3 blocks. Yeah. But I lived in a condemned neighborhood, and pretty soon my neighbors, Walter Hyatt was a neighbor, Walter and Mary Lou. She was married to Mary Lou Hyatt at the time, who managed his band, Uncle Walt's band. Guy and Susanna Clark were neighbors. Towns Van Zandt was a neighbor. Rodney Crowell was a neighbor. And nobody locked their doors, and everybody sat out on the porches and played music all night long. It was a really magical time.
New town.
And then, so I kept falling in love with songwriters. You know, they say sometimes you're attracted to some part of you that's undeveloped. I was really a late bloomer, but when I got in my mid-20s, I started writing songs, and the first 5 songs I wrote were recorded in the order they were written. I mean, and I thought, man, you know, and a guy named Jim Rushing, Jack Clement said, you and Jim ought to write songs together. So I learned a lot about the craft of songwriting from a guy from Lubbock, Texas named Jim Rushing, who's still with us, by the way. And anyway, so I ended up, I put a band together called the Lost Love Band. We used to play at a place that another club that Red Dog had started called Mississippi Whiskers was the name of it. And it was on Church Street. And I was waiting tables there for a while, and they had a pinball machine in there. And I was always at the pinball machine when customers would come in. So the manager finally decided he was either going to have to fire me or tell me to come back at night and bring my guitar. So he said, Marshall, you're the worst waitress I've ever had. Why don't you play here? Bring your guitar down here and play some of those songs. So I started doing that. And next thing I know, this place was a long, narrow club. It sold the first really good authentic Mexican food in Nashville. There was 2 guys from Mexico before the mass immigration that happened later. They were like the only 1-2 in Nashville, I think. And boy, I loved that. I lived off that food that summer. And so I started playing. I had a good band, and I was playing songs I'd written and songs I loved. And next thing I knew, these booths were like, you could reach out and touch the audience. It was just a row of booths, and then there was the wall, you know, because it was a long, skinny room, and the stage was along the long wall, facing the long wall with the booths. So you could reach out and touch the few people that were sitting there in the booths. But Jesse Coulter and Waylon Jennings came in a lot. Tom Paul Glazier came in a lot. And, you know, they're the ones that signed those things on the back of me, and I'm Feeling Free. They wrote, you know, we were the first ones to do blurbs on albums, because I noticed books had blurbs where people say, oh, this is the greatest thing I've ever read. And so my manager and I, who was very literary as well, we like to read. And so she thought, let's get some blurbs for your album. And CBS initially didn't like it, but when we started getting blurbs from Waylon and Tom Paul and all those guys, they thought it was a great idea. So we let them think it was their idea. So it would get done, you know, that one, when dealing with record companies. But anyway, Ben Talent and Bonnie Garner came in one night. They were a husband and wife at the time. And Ben was a producer. He ended up producing me, I'm Feeling Free. But Bonnie was an A&R at CBS Records, and they just signed Willie Nelson. And I think Billy Swan was on CBS briefly at that time. Johnny Paycheck, George Jones, you know, Charlie Rich. All those guys, and next thing I know, they brought Billy Sherrill in there one night, and he said, you know, she's not really my thing, but if y'all think she can do it, go ahead and sign her, because they let Bonnie sign the more progressive acts like David Allan Coe and people like that. So next thing I know, I've written about a handful of songs, and next, it's like Gidget goes to Nashville and gets a record deal, and I had a contract with CBS Records, and it was real heady stuff, you know, because they're flying me to New York, and they flew me to LA right after that. Bonnie had this great idea. It was a showcase, you know, convention kind of thing for CBS Records. You know, I mean, they had Michael Jackson and people like that performing, but for the country showcase, I remember it was at the Santa Monica Auditorium. They had me in the band, so I'm in the band playing electric rhythm guitar with a band that consisted of, you know, Johnny Gimble on fiddle and, you know, the great A-Team Nashville, Pete Drake on steel, you know, because we recorded the album at his studio. And that was the first time I learned the numbers thing that they use in studios that day. And I'm sitting there backing up George Jones and all these people. And people in the audience are wondering, who's that barefooted girl wearing a faded blue jean skirt, patched skirt, playing electric rhythm guitar, you know? And Bonnie did it so I would get the attention of the label. And then after a while, they had me step forward and sing Somewhere South of Macon, and it brought the house down. So that kind of started my CBS stint. We had a good run. I did 3 albums for them. But, you know, they never could figure out how to market me because, you know, I loved country music because of the emotion in the lyrics. But as far as my rhythm went, I was more a backbeat kind of girl. instead of that straight up and down like they do in country. It's like I heard Dan Penn say one time about the difference between country and R&B. He said, well, you know, country music, it makes you want to pat your foot. But he said, R&B, it just kind of moves on up your leg.
Hey, I love Dan. We just did the new Kudzu magazine, got him on the cover. I had a really great interview with him. He's just really, he's got a great new best. Album out, too. It's got so much soul.
Well, he's got more soul than, you know, he's just one of those Alabama guys like Donnie Fritz and Spooner Older. Those guys have got more soul than, you know. I'm trying with Black Lives Matter and everything. I'm trying not to talk black and white, but the world back then was so black and white, you know.
Yeah, I usually say it's got more soul than Shaquille O'Neal's tennis shoe.
Well, that worked.
It's a lot of soul. Hey,
well,
let's talk.
That's funny. Yeah. I just got it. I'm so little-minded. I just got it. Thank you very much.
All right, I beamed it over to you.
No, I'm gonna steal that. I like that.
Well. I don't blame you. All right. But my alarm went off and it kind of threw me off. I was timing something. I don't remember what it was.
Is it time to take a pill?
Yeah, it is. Thank you. Thank you. It is. That's exactly what it is. Now you've done 14 albums. The latest one is called Songs I Can't Live Without. And it's the first album of all cover tunes. And I'm just tickled to death by it. I mean, I love your original stuff, but you did a great job on this, doing things like Bob Seger's Turn the Page, the Elvis Don't Be Cruel, J.J. Cale After Midnight, just to name a few. How did you choose the songs to put on this album?
Well, they kind of chose me. And, you know, I wasn't going to do any more albums. You know, I think I went through a lot of trauma about 5 years ago. You know, my mom, as we said earlier, my mom died in 2015, October. And the day after she died, my divorce was final, okay? So that's bam, bam. Took a few punches to the gut. And then a week later, I had the surgery where they took off about half, well, literally a third of my nose and rebuilt it. And the antibiotics they gave me for that surgery caused me to contract something called C. diff. You know, I'm Marshall Chapman. I don't get sick, okay? But I got sick and ended up quarantined at St. Thomas Hospital in Nashville. And Chris thought I was going to die. And so I just told anybody that would listen, I wasn't going to play music anymore. I just didn't think I could travel. I lost so much weight, Buffalo. But anyway, I just wanted to do the road. So that's when I did about five movies during that time. I thought, well, I'll just do movies, you know, and I started getting calls. I mean, I didn't hustle any of them. I just got calls and everyone I read for, I got the part. And I did movies for a while and that was fun. And while making that movie where I played Ryan Reynolds' mother, it was called Mississippi Grind. That was a really cool movie. I was real proud of the work in that one. They wanted me to record a song that had the word rainbow in it, because at the beginning of the movie, you see this double rainbow out on the interstate and they keep talking about that rainbow. So they gave me a choice of all these songs. One of them was a Doug Somm song that had rainbow in the title. But one of them was Rainbow Road. And I knew it was written by Dan Penn and Donnie Fritz. So naturally I chose that one because they're both good friends of mine. And plus, I just think they're the most soulful guys on the planet. So I sang that song, and it was used in the movie, in this pivotal scene at the end. You know, these guys are gambling. They've all gotten to New Orleans, you know. And so the producer of the movie wanted me to record it with this young producer in Nashville that I'd never heard of. His name was Nielsen Hubbard. And they, one night, late at night, they sent me over to East Nashville. I was trying to find this guy's studio, and I finally found it. Walked in, and we started talking. And it's one of those things like meeting you know, you just feel like you've known the guy all your life, and he's a really cool guy, and you've got a lot of the same sensibilities about things. I just fell in love with the guy. And we just started talking, and about an hour and a half later, we were still talking. It's like, oh, yeah, we're supposed to record Rainbow Road. So I went out in the studio, did it in one take, and I'd learned all those chords, great chords in there. And because they'll throw some chords at you, Dan, and you know, that's not just that country one, 4-5 thing. And so it was such a great experience, and I love the studio. Nielsen said, you know, we ought to record an album together sometime. And so we kept up, and then 5 years later, we did. And that's where Songs I Can't Live Without was recorded, in that same studio. And if I hadn't done that movie, it never would have happened. Yeah. But I just made a list, and you know, I didn't think about it at the time, but it's probably the most Americana album out there. And when it came time to put the album out, the guy that promotes, you know, to radio, he's a friend of mine here now. He didn't want to work the album. He said, you know, it's hard to get cover albums on the radio. And he said, I just don't want to take your money. That's what he said. I said, you know, let me worry about that. Okay. Let's just, you know, like Joe South used to say, you got to run it up the flagpole, because you never know, somebody might walk by and salute, you know? So I finally I had to talk him and the publicist into working this record. It got great press. It's selling good, you know? Well, and one of the reasons, besides it was a cover album, I told them I wasn't going on the road. And they said, Marshall, you're not going to sell any CDs. And I said, well, we'll just see what happens. And I didn't know COVID was going to hit. And of course, when COVID hit Buffalo, now the playing field's level. Nobody's touring, so there's no difference between Marshall Chapman and Garth Brooks, you know. None of us can tour, so we're all on the same level playing field. I mean, so the record's done, you know. We sell hard CDs. Amazon sells them too, but we sell them, you know, from my website, which I'd like to mention, which is tallgirl.com. I guess you'll have that all on here when you do this interview.
Obviously.
But if they go there, right there on the front page, if they scroll down a little bit, they'll see the new album. But people that buy it through my website, I include a 4-page essay I wrote that tells them about what I'm telling you. This is my 14th album, my first of songs that I did not write, songs that have kept my soul alive over the years. And I tell the story about Rainbow Road and meeting Nielsen and then us doing an album together. And then I write a little short paragraph about each song. Did I send that to you? I will.
No. I'd love to have that. I've got the CD, but I don't have the story.
Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be great. One thing I didn't know about, obviously, until last Saturday, was that every Saturday you've been doing these live shows on Facebook, live streams.
Right.
And man, that was more fun than a barrel of monkeys. I highly recommend everybody to tune in on Saturdays for
3 p.m. Well, 4 p.m. your time, yeah.
Eastern Standard, yeah.
And this Saturday would be my 25th consecutive one. Last night when I couldn't sleep, I was running my thumbnail over my calluses, and I thought, God, my calluses haven't been this hard since I was in my late 20s promoting those epic albums, you know, playing 300 shows a year, you know.
Well, yeah, but, I mean, you can't get out and tour, but you're doing a great thing, and it's a great service. I've watched a lot of online stuff since the coronavirus deal.
Right.
But yours is so intimate, and you and Chris just work with you know, talking to the people that are watching, and you know, it kind of feels like you're in our living room or something.
Yeah, it's
that's
crazy.
It's pretty cool.
And you know, we've got a few people. Actually, you know, there's about 100 of them that tune in every damn week. And
of course.
And they're from all over the world. There's a woman from Norway. There's a woman in West Wales. You know, there's a woman in Portugal. There's a woman that says she lives on the mountainside of British Columbia. And I've gotten to know that. And then there's this one couple that has seen every show. And I remember I know all their names now and where they live. I mean, it's crazy. And I talked to them, it's like they've become my family with all the isolation and everything. I mean, it's amazing.
It's great. Well, I noticed that somebody on there Saturday was a relative of Cowboy Jack Clement.
Yeah, his daughter, Allison Clement, tuned in and wanted me to, that was the I think that was her second time tuning in. The first time she asked me to sing, Let's All Help the Cowboys Sing the Blues. And, you know, I'm 71 now. And I left out the second verse. So she, you know, they send messages. I love the way it's interactive.
Oh, yeah, it
is. And she sent a message with the words to the second verse. So I sang it again with the second verse in there.
Oh, yeah, that's cool.
I love the way it's interactive, you know. And I, you know what I'm calling those shows? I'm calling it Perfect Imperfection. Because, you know, when people, and it's like Stump the Band. There's a guy that tunes in every week that was in my band when I opened for the Marshall Tucker Band at Spartanburg Memorial Auditorium. Oh, yes. He was in my, I had picked his whole band up in Fort Worth, Texas, and taken him on the road to promote Me, I'm Feeling Free. And so he was, it was his band, so he was playing rhythm guitar in my band. Robert Chaton, his name, he's a great artist, great songwriter himself. But he tunes in every week, and he asked me to sing songs like, you know, that I hadn't sung in years, like Two Fires Burning Bright. They burn together. They light up the night. Never burning each other. You look at me. Your two eyes excite me. There's a fire in your soul, burning out of control. That's what ignites me. Can this flame of desire be an eternal thing? I mean, I had totally forgotten about that song. And I thought, wow. Shit, man. Why didn't I get that to Jerry Lee Lewis? And this flame of desire.
I can see that.
Be an eternal thing. And only somebody in their 20s would write this. Yes, forever is ours. If you feel the same, you feel the same. Now let's burn this candle till both ends meet. I mean, it's just... And I just laughed thinking about those lyrics because I was just so full of piss and vinegar back then writing those songs.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I couldn't write a song like that now. I wouldn't want to, but I'm glad I wrote it then.
Yeah. Well, I've got a couple of more things I want to ask you about, and then hopefully I've got a song request after that. But the, just wanted to ask your overall thoughts on the year 2020. I mean, we're not going diving too deep. The coronavirus, the unrest, the state of the nation, everything. I've never seen anything like this in my life.
Nobody
has. And what do you think there's hope?
I tell you, I don't know. I don't know. I may start crying if I think about it too much.
Yeah, exactly.
I do. I weep. I'm praying a lot. I'll tell you that.
Yeah.
I'm praying a lot. And I pray for President Trump. When I sit down to every meal, I pray for him. Because I don't think that man has been shown one ounce of love his entire life. He does not know how to love. He's just like a shark in the ocean, eating anything that's in his path. And it's really frightening that he's running the country. And I don't want to get political because I'm from South Carolina.
Yeah.
And the only political thing I ever wrote, I said, I've never let politics stop me from loving anybody. And that's my stance on politics. But I will vote. And I think it's so important to vote because I think the very existence of our country is at stake. And of course, when I was in Spartanburg, I was with one of my friends who talks like that and says geology. And she said, but Marshall, don't you think Nancy Pelosi and all them going to lead us down the road to socialism? I said, what do you think Social Security is? And it's the most successful program we've ever done. That's socialism. But that's one of those words that people just go crazy when they hear it.
Yeah.
Like, next step is communism. But we've got, it's worse than, you know, what it is Putin's really running the country right now. He's calling the shots. I mean, I believe that. And I think it's frightening. The America, as I've known it, it's disappearing so fast. I'm not sure, you know, I'm just hoping I die before it's gone. I'm sorry, I'm knocking on wood, because damn, it's got me thinking I want to just move to the beach and just, or to an, it, I don't know. I don't know what to say. I wear a mask. I believe the scientists. I don't believe politicians when it comes to my health. I believe doctors and scientists when it comes to my health and my own gut and intuition. And of course, my former husband, who I'm now dating, and we're hanging out a lot and we're doing better than we ever have. He lives a half mile from here, but he's a doctor by training, and he knows. And we were wearing masks before anybody was wearing a mask. And people, there was a guy, and the guy that lives right behind this wall right here in his bedroom, sometimes I can hear he's a guy from Memphis, and he's a big Republican. And he calls me libtard. You know, he thinks I'm crazy. But you know what? He loves me. He loves me to death. I've made him love me. Because and I take care of things when he's out of town, and I love him. I don't know why I love him so much, but I do. Oh. And we are at opposite ends of the spectrum. And I had a woman cleaning my house the other day, who's I've known. She's more like a friend. I mean, she was cleaning my house. We were cleaning my house, because when she comes over, I roll up my sleeves just so I can hang out with her. And she's from a small town in Tennessee, and she told me she was going to vote for Trump, and I got real depressed for a while. And then we sat down and talked. She said, "You want to know why I'm voting?" And I said, "Yeah." And we had the most respectful conversation. And it was all about religion to her, because she's very religious. I don't know why, because her grandfather was a preacher and he sexually abused her, but she is. And she believes in the King James Version of the Bible. And if you read that and you're a woman, you'll want to open a vein. But she said, because of abortion. That's what she said. And she said, I said, is it finances? Because, you know, I've got a lot of friends, Buffalo, and you probably do too, that as long as their portfolio's doing good and they're doing good financially, they're going to vote for whoever's in office if the stock market's doing well. It's all about money to them. So, right. And I understand that they don't want to look at and they said, well, I'm going to vote for him. I just wish he'd keep his damn mouth shut. You know, they say things like that. But Felina, it wasn't money for her. It was just that one issue. And she said, I can't vote for Joe Biden because he's pro-abortion. And we got to have this greatest discussion, because I said, Felina, I totally respect what your decision. But here's the deal. Nobody is pro-abortion. So get that word. You know, I said, you shouldn't say that about anybody, because that is a tragic decision that some women, unfortunately, feel like they're forced to make. So no, let's just get that on the table. Nobody is pro-abortion, because it's a tragic situation. How can you say you're for that? But pro-life, there's just a different language. It's just not as incendiary. So we had this great conversation and hugged at the end of it, and we looked at each other and thought, it's just a shame everybody in America can't have a discussion like, because I understood her better and she understood me better, you know. And she said, well, Marshall, I've always called you my liberal mother, because I had a real right-wing religious mother, very rigid, and I couldn't talk to her about so many things that I could talk to you about, you know. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. And I, after our conversation, even though she's gonna vote for Trump and I'm gonna vote for Biden, Joe Biden, I don't mind saying that on the air. I hope it's something I've never done. I've never talked like this to anybody, because I usually stay away from politics when it comes to my music. Because it's like Michael Jordan said, you know, Republicans like to wear tennis shoes too, you know, because he was selling tennis shoes. And I'm trying to make a living selling music. So forgive me if I'm putting anybody off, but I still have to do what I believe. And I don't think anybody that's elected, even if Jesus H. Christ came back from the dead and we made him president of the United States, no matter who's up there, I don't think a lot of these problems are going to change, because it's not the leadership. It's who votes in the leadership. And we've got a lot of people who have so much fear that manifests itself in hate. And that's where all the white supremacists, they feel like they're going to lose something if somebody who's not the same color they are gets ahead. Somehow it diminishes them. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah.
And we got, and that's where racism comes from. And I'm very much, this whole thing has broken my heart. The George Floyd, like everybody, anybody in America that sees that tape of that officer with his knee on that guy's neck, snuffing while he called out, "Mama, mama, I can't breathe, mama." If that didn't touch your heart, and I think it touched a lot of people's hearts, but there's some people in America, like I said, who have so much fear that manifests itself in hate that they couldn't feel that. And I've got a song I just wrote that I did. I think I did it on the show you saw this past Saturday. And I talked about this. I said, and I dedicate it to not only George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and these people that have lost their lives unnecessarily. And the guy that was Jacob Blake, shot in the back 7 times in front of his children. That breaks my heart. But also the people who aren't touched by that, that breaks my heart too. And I dedicate the song to both of them. And I send my love to the, to Floyd and his family and Breonna Taylor and her family. My love goes out to them, but my love, who needs love more than these people that are hating and wanting to kill? You know, in the name of their political beliefs, who needs love more than those mostly guys? But I'm sure there's some women out there too.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's breaking my heart, and we're tearing. It's so insane in Washington right now. We have had no government for 3 years. And getting back to one more point, I was heading in this direction. Joe Biden, Donald, whoever's in there, if it was Jesus Christ, now, I don't think it's going to change things other than the rhetoric coming out of Washington. And I'm ready for this divisive, hateful, lying rhetoric to stop. And that's why I'm voting for Joe Biden. Hmm.
Well, at least, okay, now tell me what you really think. No, I'm just kidding. all right, well, thanks for sharing all that.
Be gentle with me. When you start editing, you might want to edit all
this out. Well, this, the other thing about it is this video will not be edited. This is it, baby. So, okay, you know, that's all right. You didn't say anything that wrong, so there you go. Well, I want to wrap up by I want to see if you'll play a song. I want to know if you'll take a request.
Yeah, if I can.
I'm sure you can. Just played it Saturday.
My listeners, when I live stream, I said, just because I wrote them don't mean I remember them.
This is my favorite Marshall Chapman song. And it's Goodbye Little Rock and Roller.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I think
it's very autobiographical, I think, if I'm not mistaken.
Well, I tell people it's semi-autobiographical, which means about half of it's true, and the other half I made up just so it would rhyme, you know?
Yeah, it's like Pat Conway said in his books. He told me, I write faction, which is fiction based on fact.
Well, and right. It's like an ex-boyfriend of mine who's a writer, Dave Hickey, once said, you save the truth for fiction. Because you can write about hard truths and clothe it in fiction that you would never say in nonfiction, you know?
Yeah, that's true.
God, now that you want me to sing, I can barely talk because I've got a big frog that just came up in my throat.
Well, you'll come out sounding like Dylan, maybe. That'd be great.
Well, let's see what we can do here. Let me get this thing. I'll move it away.
All right. So
get a little bit of guitar in there. How's all that? Right.
Yeah, that's cool. That's great. Very good.
Hey, we're getting practice.
Oh, yeah, that's my life.
As Waylon says, this ain't no run through. This is the big time. We are professionals. Once there was a little girl, unlike any in the world. The night she looked inside her soul, and all she saw, rock and roll, her dad bought her an old guitar. She never dreamed she'd be a star. She worked her fingers to the bone on that Sears and Roebuck silver tone guitar. She played that guitar all day long, put her feelings into song, and sang her songs for Lula Mae, who said, "Child, you got just what it takes." We all knew she'd leave somehow, find the world she dreamed about. She never turned around that day to see her sister wave to her and say, "Goodbye, the rock and roll." She it sure was good to know you. Goodbye, my little rock and roll. Goodbye. Yeah, now she hitchhiked to Hollywood like everybody knew she would. She put a rockin' band together, they made plans, they cut a record, the rest was history, they say. She took off down the fast highway, and people came from miles around. While every night she burned them down. That's my little Johnny Cash tribute right there.
Yeah.
And all the fortune, and all the fame, and all the lights around her name. And every night was now or never. The road just seemed to go forever. And all her dreams, it had come true. They didn't thrill her like they used to. She never thought she'd grow to hear a voice inside her strong and clear sing, "Goodbye, little rock and roll." She it sure was good to know you. Bye, my little rock and roll. Goodbye. She found a place down by the sea. That place was called Serenity, and there she learned life goes on. God, somebody's calling. There she learned that life goes on. Life is more than just a song. You'll never guess what happened then. She met a gentle man named Ben, and together they made love so real. They made a baby girl named Lucille. She rocked Lucille to sleep each night, sang her lullaby she'd write. She thought her heart would break in two the first time she heard, "Mom, I love you." And then one day her baby girl walked outside to find her world. She never dreamed she'd see the day she'd be fighting back the tears to say, "Goodbye, I'm a little rock and roller. Gee, it sure was good to know you. Goodbye, I'm a little rock and roller. Goodbye. Goodbye, little rock and roller. Gee, it sure was good to know you. Goodbye, little rock and roller. Goodbye." Thank you, Buffalo.
Thank you. That's my favorite Marshall song. I really appreciate that. And thank you for doing this today. I know everybody's gonna be coming on over to your website and hopefully
ordering. I hope so. You got me off on politics now, and that's something I never do.
Well, but, I didn't intend to, but it's okay. It's everybody. The way that you told it though was basically saying,
you gotta love everybody.
You gotta love everybody, and that's great. That's what it's all about. That goes all the way back to John Lennon. Love John is all Lennon you need.
And let me tell you, Will Campbell, he said, if you're gonna love one, you gotta love them all.
That's true.
Isn't that great? I love that. That's true. Yeah. It's easy to love people that think like we do. I probably love, Trump more than my mother because he needs it more. I'll leave you with that.
Oh, all right. Well, thanks a bunch, Marshall. I appreciate
this
a whole bunch.
I love you. My love is as big as you are.
And that's quite a lot smaller than it was last time you saw me, but still big enough.
Big enough. You look
big enough
good,
to be big enough to be a buffalo.
I'm glad we're both on this side of the dirt.
Yeah, me too. I thank you, and I will be watching Saturday again.
Great. We look forward to having you, man. I love you.
Love you. Thanks.